I just want to highlight that this conference, as humble as it may seem, is a great step for us. In a long time, as I can remember, we had not had a student-led theological conference, but especially led by associations of students of color. So this is a great accomplishment, and we're very happy and proud of it. Very good. So our first keynote speaker of the day is Mariama White-Hammond. She's an activist and ordained minister of the AME Church. She majored in international relations, studied abroad in Chile, and focused on the political and economic development in Latin America and the Caribbean. Reverend Mariama is also a fellow with the Green Justice Coalition, a collaborative of people of color-led environmental groups. And before she comes here, I just want to share with you an anecdote. One day I was leaving my office and I was on my daily commute, and as I was driving on I-93, I tune in to NPR. And there I hear this voice, and I start thinking, wait a second, I have heard this voice before. And they were talking about police brutality and the situation in Boston, and I kept hearing this voice. And I said, wait a second, I know this person. And then the speaker addresses this voice and said, Reverend White-Hammond. And I said, oh my goodness, I know her, she's one of our students. And I broke the law, this is indecency. And I texted to Professor Rambo saying, Mariama is on NPR right now. So thank you very much, Mariama. We're glad to have you here today.
Thank you.
Please welcome her.
So I have a little confession for you this morning, which is that I had crafted my remarks maybe a little based on some previous remarks, and I was ready to go. And spent some time in prayer this morning and realized that a lot of what I was doing was inspirational, but that in reality, I'm kind of speaking to the choir a little bit today. And so I'm going to do a little bit of sort of a reminder of why we are here and framing this moment. And then I will really talk a little bit more about what I think we need to do a little bit more nuts and bolts like in a workshop-y kind of fashion, and then we'll go straight into engagement. Because I do think in this moment, many of us are fired up and inspired, and then the question is, what do we do with that feeling? So, I know we are a school of theology, but I thought, you know, maybe we could start from a biblical passage. I know I will be talking about the Jesus movement, but I want to start from a scripture in 1 Kings, the third chapter, verses 16 to 27. It's a story that we're probably pretty familiar with, but I'd like to reflect on it and then ask us to interrogate our interpretation of it a little bit this morning. And so the scripture says, later, two women who were prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. The one woman said, please, my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth while she was in the house. Then on the third day after I gave birth, this woman also gave birth. We were together. There was no one else with us in the house. Only the two of us were in the house. Then the woman's son died in the night, because she lay on him. She got up in the middle of the night and took my son from beside me while your servant slept. She laid him at her breast and laid her dead son at my breast. When I rose in the morning to nurse my son, I saw that he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning, clearly it was not the son I had born. But the other woman said, no, the living son is mine and the dead son is yours. The first said, no, the dead son is yours and the living son is mine. So they argued before the king. Then the king said, the one says, this is my son that is alive and your son is dead, while the other says, not so, your son is dead and my son is the living one. So the king said, bring me a sword. And they brought a sword before the king. The king said, divide the living boy in two, then give half to the one and half to the other. But the woman whose son was alive said to the king, because compassion for her son burned within her, please, my lord, give her the living boy. Certainly do not kill him. The other said, it shall be neither mine nor yours divided. Then the king responded, give the first woman the living boy. Do not kill him. She is the mother. So this is a fairly familiar passage, I think, to most of us. We know that the king in this conversation is King Solomon, and I won't talk too much about King Solomon's rise to the throne. We've all taken Hebrew Bible, so we know that there's a little bit of a dubious situation as to how he has come to this place in the first, and that his father and his mother and the situations of both his birth and ascendancy are filled with family drama. And yet, here we have these two women bringing before him what is, in essence, quite a serious family, roommate, even you might call it, drama. It's important to remember that these women in Israelite society are of the lowest status. And the scripture makes that very clear to us by starting off with the assertion that they are prostitutes. And the reality is, for them to be in that situation, something went wrong. Somehow they got disconnected from the family or the community that should have taken care of them and found themselves in the lowest of places. And the reality is that these sons are more than just babies to love. They are more than just these children that they pray for. They are their chance out, their opportunity at some level of respectability in a society where their very livelihood and their very lives are at question. And so losing a child is not just the anguish that any parent would feel if your child was dead, but also losing your chance at the possibility of a re-entrance into society through a male child who could grow up and potentially take care of you, find you a way to live in your old age. So it's important for us to recognize, while there's also certainly, I'm sure, just love for the infant, there's also a socio-political context in which these women are living that is the backdrop to this story. So I want to assert that, of course, we don't exactly know what happened. Of course, most of this is narrated from the voice of one of the women, and I want to be careful about thinking that if we've heard from one, we know exactly what happened. But either way, what we know is that one of them was motivated by loss. Someone lost their child in the night, and somehow that loss led them to do something either by bringing a false claim to the king or by taking the other child in the night. One of them, motivated by loss, decided to take their pain out on the other. And the scripture shows us, in the way that it's framed, that one, we assume the woman whose son died was motivated by loss, but the other one is motivated by love, which means that she puts the child first. She is sacrificial in her love, and she doesn't just speak of the love for her child, she shows it in her willingness to let him go to save his life. So I think why is this important for us in this moment? Why is it more than just a biblical scripture that we've heard? I think we are in a moment where our country is increasingly motivated by a sense of loss. We are haunted by the reality that our way of life is dying, that it is not sustainable, that our grandchildren will not be able to live the way we have lived. That the American dream, the idea that your next generation will have more than you had, it's just not even possible. And that sense of loss is dangerous. In addition, we have a sense that our physical security is threatened. And I want to be clear about the fact that while terrorism is real, the challenge is also that it is so ubiquitously talked about that it feels more of a danger than in reality it actually is. And I say that just because there are people dying every day from things that we have no intention of changing and we are not putting any energy to, and yet we are deeply motivated by the fear that a bomb might be planted, deeply motivated by the fear that we might be in danger of a mass shooting. And so we're living in a time where our physical security feels threatened constantly. And then in this last couple of years, and maybe it's not 100% new, but we have seen eroded the idea that there's any sense of basic decency in how we should treat each other. The kinds of things you're allowed to say these days, the kinds of people you're allowed to attack. I thought we lived in a country where you couldn't speak out against veterans, but apparently I was wrong. And so this sense that there is no basic standard that we hold together, nothing that we can hold each other accountable to, is also a sense of loss that pervades our society. And of course, we saw a lot of this play itself out in the election. One person told us about loss and told us who to blame. We were told that it's those people coming over from that country, it's those people crossing that river, it's all of these people that need to get down with law and order. This is the reason that we're in this situation. And then the other person just told us to be scared of the first person. And so either way, we were in a place of fear and loss. And neither, in my opinion, deeply addressed the root causes of the place that we're in as a country. Nobody was willing to have a deep conversation about the economic situation that we're in. We couldn't even have an honest conversation about climate change and the fact that the very planet on which we depend, the only home that we have as of now, is literally eroding beneath us. And the reality is that in this election, we saw that on all sides, there was nobody who said that love rather than loss could lead us. Question is, do we even know what it means to be motivated by a sense of love? And I know that we're in a theology school and love is not a term that I could write a dissertation on necessarily. But I do think it's an important thing. In so many places in our country, we don't even have a sense that we are one country altogether. Even have the sense that we're in it together. Now we all have families, we know that not every day and not every time do you like the family that you're in. But there's something important about feeling like, come hell or high water, these are my peoples. Again, not always a thing that is right on the surface, but it's always there. And so we have this place where we have blue cores that are in tension with red rural communities. We actually even have started to define ourselves by these oppositional colors. And we talk about a growing inequity, and we talk about a situation in our economic system that's not working, but other than complaining about it, it's not very clear what our vision is beyond that. And so I always suggest that one of the big challenges, not just for the country, but I think particularly for the church, is what we often say in hip hop, which is don't talk about it, be about it. And what we have struggled to do is not even, we are struggling to talk about it, but we're also struggling to be about it. And so in this season as the church, the challenge for us is to ask the question, can we shift the conversation from loss to love? Can we say that there's a way in which we can approach the future of this nation that doesn't get rid of anybody, that doesn't other people, and that doesn't come from the notion that in order for me to get ahead, you have to go down? Is there a way for us to call or to speak out against the idea that deporting undocumented young people is going to make our country better? Or that if we just had fewer Muslims, we'd be a better country? Or that if workers would just be satisfied with the wages that we have, then they would be able to get ahead? Or if black people just live with the fact that the police are doing the best that they can? Or that, you know, it's just not realistic to get rid of our SUVs or to live a more sustainable lifestyle. If we could push back on these notions and to say that a world led by love is a world where we can address all of the injustices without getting rid of anyone. But lastly, I want to interrogate this text just a little bit. Because in its solution, it does seem to suggest that only one mother could win. The mother motivated by loss, at the end, walks away with nothing. And the mother motivated by love seems to finish triumphant. But what seems to me problematic about that is that ultimately this child, if they walk away with just this one mother, would literally only have one mother. This is a woman who's already been cast aside, and so she's going to end up doing it pretty much on her own. Would it not have been a better solution to assert that this child would be better off with two mothers, with twice as much support as the one mother can give? And would it not have also been better to question a society that sets up these women having to care for these children by themselves? Maybe they wouldn't have been in that situation if a community had come around them. Maybe somebody would have been able to watch the child and they wouldn't have been in a situation where one of them had to roll over the child in the first place. And so I think our goal is not just to hold one above the other, but to ask some deep questions about why are people finding themselves in situations where they have to make impossible choices.
Yes.
We live in a country with more than enough resources. We live in a world with more than enough resources, and yet we never ask questions about why those resources were not distributed differently to create better outcomes. And so while I do say that we should choose a spirit of love over a spirit of loss, I also challenge that we have to leave anybody behind, even this mother who in a moment of desperation chose to do something that in theory is unthinkable, though in reality, I could imagine what it meant in a moment to look at what you, this child that was your love and salvation, and to think that they were gone. And so I challenge us as the church, as the academy, as people of faith in this moment to take an opportunity to stand for love, but also to think outside the box about what it means to build a beloved society. So I want us to think really quickly and talk quickly about what that means specifically. And I will talk about this a little bit using a couple of key examples, and then we will jump into our time for questions. And I think we're pushing lunch back just a little bit, so we have a little bit more time. So I'm gonna just go through this for the next 10 minutes so that we still will have ample time. So I want to suggest that there are five steps that we need to embrace if we are going to speak prophetically in this time and call for a country and a society led by love and not by loss. The first is I think we need to connect powerfully with the Holy Spirit. What we're basically looking for here is a miracle. I mean, let's just be honest about human history and our ability to move beyond ourselves and step outside of ourselves and do the right things and to imagine that something better is possible. It can happen. It has happened. But it is, unfortunately, the rarer thing sometimes when we come together. And so in this moment, if we are going to break through, I believe that we need a radical move of the Holy Spirit. And I think that move many times needs to begin with us as leaders. As folks that start to imagine and believe and act like we believe that God could intervene in human history to change things on a level that we couldn't even begin to ask or imagine. I believe that functioning from that place changes how you walk into every church meeting. It changes how you ride the trains. It changes how you have conversations with people that you don't agree with. It changes how you interact with the police. When you start to believe that the Holy Spirit might be able to move in a radical and powerful way, it changes how you move through situations. I'll give an example of this that from my experience in Standing Rock. I've been out there, and as you know, the situation there is still not where it needs to be. And yet, I saw something powerful in people rising up in a way that has not happened in more than 100 years for most of the Native folks that I've talked to. And we had this incident where, there's a lot of backstory to it, but we found ourselves in Bismarck, North Dakota, in front of the governor's mansion. This is mostly clergy leaders. About 500 clergy leaders went to Standing Rock in early November. And I would say this. I think there were many good things that happened today. I wouldn't say it was the most organized. We sort of made a decision and went, and there were moments when I was like, I don't know if this was the best decision. And on our way there, the state police were following us, which meant we knew that they were kind of know we got there. And when we got there, they were locking down the entire state health complex. There was no place to use the bathroom. I mean, it was like they were just locking it all down and evacuating state workers. And so we ended up in front of the governor's mansion, his mansion is literally like on the state house complex. And so folks are singing and praying and doing speeches. And I do at some other point want to talk about, and this will be one of the things I talk about a little bit, is, what real nonviolent direct action is. It is not just the absence of weapons. It comes from a different and deeper place. But we were standing out, and a group of clergy decided to cross the street to kneel on the governor's front lawn. And that, of course, ratcheted up. So they had already brought in a bus. There were a lot of police officers there. But when they crossed the street, they were surrounded by 12 officers. And then they started surrounding us with riot cops. And came across and said we needed to disperse or they were going to arrest us. And before we even really had time to process, because like I said, we hadn't exactly done some of the things I usually think one should do, like figure out who the decision-making group is going to be and clarify what your civil disobedience actions are. All of these things that I usually believe that we should do, we had not done them. And so we were in a moment where we were literally surrounded by riot police without a clarity about how to make a decision. And suddenly the police arrested one young man. So it was mostly white clergy, but he happened to be one of the few indigenous people who was there because most of the indigenous people had already been arrested in previous arrests and couldn't get arrested again because they would not be eligible for bail with a subsequent arrest. And so he gets arrested. And we're sitting here in this moment. Folks are upset. Police officer comes back. Somebody yells, "Why did you take him?" And I could see, it's like there are some moments where you can feel the energy, and the tension was certainly rising in that moment. And so the officer's just saying to disperse, and I said, "Excuse me, officer, I just need to help you. Can you understand our perspective on this?" And he says, "I just arrested whoever was in front of me because I told you all to move." I said, "But could you see how there's about 60 of us? Most of us are white. And somehow you managed to arrest one of the few people of color. Now, maybe I hear you saying that's an accident, but could you see how we see this situation?" And of course, he didn't say, "Oh, yes, I get it. White privilege, racial injustice going on." That's not what he said. He said, "I told you all to disperse, and you didn't." So someone started yelling, and I said, "Wait, can we just, let's not yell." I said, "Okay, so I understand where you're coming from." I said, "But all of us did the same thing that he did, which is stand here and not move. And I don't know if we even had enough time to process what happened. And so we feel like it's unfair that he's been arrested when the rest of us have not been." And so you saw a moment where he processed, and I said, "And we will leave if you'll release him." He said, "You can go to the other protest area." He said, "No, we won't even go to the other protest area. We will all leave if you will release him." So when he left and went and started having conversations with other police officers, and then someone came over, and of course our group almost got excited, and then turned to the group and sort of said, "This is a moment where what we do will make all the difference as to whether Eric is released or not." And that was the brother had been arrested. And then you saw the police negotiating. You saw them huddling. You saw felt the tension begin to lower as they asked themselves the question, were they going to let go of this young man that they had arrested? And we sort of stood quietly. I said, we're not even going to sing. We're just going to stay in quietly and just watch. And eventually they came back over and said, you all will all leave? I said, we'll all leave. I said, we won't even cheer. We'll leave quietly. And so they released him, and he came, and they let us walk away. And literally the police who had lined up parted and allowed us to walk through. And on the other side, there was a lot of supporters, including a lot of the indigenous folks who were not able to get arrested because of this moment. And so as we got back to where we were staying, people were like really excited, and the story is circulating, and people are like, hey, I heard this happen. And, it was a moment where I recognized that even as people of faith, we don't always believe that the Spirit can move. We don't believe that other options are possible than the ones that we've continued to see again and again. And so, for me in that moment, it's not that I'm like a skilled negotiator. I didn't say anything that crazy or different than anybody else could have. But I did believe that there was a possibility that the Spirit could get through to these officers. That they didn't wake up in the morning hoping to arrest people of color and lock people up. And just that little bit of belief allowed me to see the situation in what I did not think was an altogether radical way. But I recognized after that when you believe the Spirit can do things, you start to open up for the possibility that the Spirit will move. And then you behave very differently. And I don't know if we really believe enough that the Spirit can or that the Spirit will. And I think that shades all of what we do. And I'm a community organizer. I believe in organizing. That's point five, right? We'll get to that. But starting from the notion that something different is possible, I think will make us attractive to people who are really trying to figure out how we move this country forward. And they may not join the church, and they may not come to anything, religious, and they may not, they may not become members. But they may start to think that there's something powerful about that Jesus movement, something that they believe, something about the way they are that distinguishes from other folks. And so that is my first belief, that if we can connect powerfully and believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, it makes all the difference. The second is that I think we need to, particularly in our congregations, bring alive the socio-political context of the text. Most of the stuff that we're living with, it's like in here, right? Now, I know that we all have different relationships and challenges with the text. It's a tough thing. I'm not denying any of that. But for instance, I've been taking our young people through a deep study of Esther. I don't have to say anything that crazy. It's in there, right? But because they've never thought about it, because they've never thought about what it really meant for Israel to be in exile, and what it meant to be left behind, what it meant to be in the king's court and having to downplay who you are, potentially, right? They haven't thought about the connection between that time and our time. And there are many powerful stories, and particularly for those of us who are in more conservative denominations, for those who of us, so for instance, in the black church context, talking about different ways of reading the text, not always like people ready to do that, right? And so sometimes starting from something that people think, and going there from something that people find is authoritative, allows us to really get there deeper, faster, and to hear what God is saying. But a lot of it means not just reading the scriptures, but telling people, what was Jesus talking about when he talks about the pigs throwing themselves into the sea, right? If you don't know the context of the Roman soldiers and what he was commenting on, then, it sounds like a farm reference to you, right? And so I think we really need to dig in, and I am thankful for my time here. It's given me a lot to work from. But I think there's a lot here that we don't hold on to really push our folks about the times that we're in and how they compare to the times of previous. Third, we need to raise questions about the mission and purpose of individuals and the church as a whole. Sometimes I don't even think people know what they're supposed to be doing as Christians or what the church's role even is. And I'm not saying we have to even tell people. Sometimes I just ask people, well, what do you think it means to be a Christian? Sometimes the most powerful recognition for them is that they actually are not 100% sure. And that really gives us an opportunity to say, okay, if we're supposed to follow Christ, let's look at what he did. And what does that mean for what we're supposed to be doing? Asking people these questions, sometimes rather than telling them, I think is a powerful way to get your church to start asking and your folks in your ministry to start asking, am I living out what I'm supposed to be living out? If Jesus was with the marginalized, how often are you in relationship with the marginalized? How often are you in relationship with people who don't look like you, who are not from your neighborhood, people who are struggling, or people in your neighborhood who are struggling that you're still sometimes walking over on your way to church? Right? Sometimes we read these scriptures and we imagine these people, you know, the people that pass the Samaritan, that they're like somebody else, right? Sometimes those people are us. And we need to have real moments where we ask ourselves, am I making the mark on the mission and the purpose that I'm called to? And I think we don't ask these questions enough, so then people aren't asking them of themselves, and we're not asking it as a church enough, so then we just keep doing stuff. You know, plenty of activity. Is our activity making an impact? Sometimes I don't think we even ask those questions. And so I do think that's a really important part of the work, is asking those questions. Fourth, elevating the stories of parishioners and community members that connect, then connecting with systemic problems. I think it's great to give people statistics on mass incarceration. But if you want hearts to move and you want people to start moving, they need to hear from someone who's come out of the prison system. Statistics don't move people. Stories move people. When statistics move us, it's because we can connect them to stories that already exist in our wheelhouse, when we can imagine them connected to real people. And so I think we need to start connecting. And sometimes there's people in your own congregation who are struggling, and then their voices are not lifted up. They're not, you know, told, you know what, this struggle is not your fault. So that's the other thing is, you know, we do have some theologies about sin that we need to interrogate, that make people sometimes feel like their struggle is just their own. But I think we need to create a space for people to talk about where they're struggling and then connect that struggle to systemic challenges. And then finally, we just need to train some folks in some basic organizing. Not enough churches do basic, basic organizing stuff. How to have a one-on-one with somebody. Share your story, hear their story. Basic things like how to run a proper meeting. Not by Robert's rules, which I think stink. I just want to say that. I feel like we could get rid of Robert's rules in all of the faith, and I think we'd be better off. Not to hate on Robert, I'm sure he tried really hard to get it. My experience is that they only work for the people who know them really well, and so then they actually don't increase democracy, but that's a whole other thing. But I do think, I can't tell you how many bad, poorly run meetings I've been to in church. And bad meetings do not produce transformational outcomes. So I know this seems like not a sexy thing to put in a keynote, but I just need to name how many of you have sat through more than 10 bad meetings in your life? 10 hours of your life that you wish you had back. This is a problem. I also want to name, I've been to some bad meetings in academy too, so that is for even those of you who are definitely going, bad meetings are ubiquitous, and we need to work on it. Because really people show up hoping to make something happen, and sometimes their souls are crushed and their time is wasted by poor planning, by bad process, and so I, again, no, it's not sexy, but I think doing some basic training in that way could be transformative. So with that, I'm gonna stop. I'm gonna create a space for people to ask questions of me or of each other. I have a few more stories that I cut out to make sure that we finished in enough time. So if they make sense to tell, I will do that. But thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you for bringing up the question, what is the individual, what is the church to do today? You know, what is the role? I've been horrified by the latest budget proposal and the cuts to programs like Meal on Wheels, cuts to a lot of programs, all in the name of, and this is what I find interesting, cutting all these programs so we can increase our defense budget.
Mm-hmm.
I have two problems with that. Number one is a matter of consistency. How are we going, how are some people going to claim that they are for fiscal responsibility and yet defense spending somehow doesn't fall into that?
Mm-hmm.
But let's cut arts, let's cut this, let's cut all this other stuff. But second is that I hear too much that we are a Christian nation. I would say, I wish we live in a Christian nation sometimes. Because when I look at politics, and when I look at politicians saying we live in a Christian nation, I'm thinking to myself, no, actually, we're a nation of, because it's the reality. I used to be a political science student before I became this. We are a nation of the end justifies the means.
Mm-hmm.
And the end justifies the means is not Christian. So one thing that we could do as well is to challenge the just war ideas that are very much steeped in Western church.
Yep.
We need to do what they do in the East. It's not perfect. War is always an evil. Even when it's a lesser evil,
mm-hmm.
to fight another evil, it is still an evil that needs to be called like that.
Right.
The challenge, of course, is in this society, there are people who serve in the military and they really want to serve.
Yep.
So my challenge is, and maybe you want to talk about that, how do we, on the one hand, bring into the foreground that this is wrong,
yep.
but at the same time, not wanting to disregard the service of people?
So I think, I have sort of two answers to that.
Yeah, okay.
So one of them is, going back to the notion of interrogating the text, I want us to have real hard conversations about what things really worked out for people. So for instance, I have a very complicated relationship with David. Because David, there's no other way to put it, David raped Bathsheba. There's no other way to clean it up. I know that we want to, but that relationship couldn't have been consensual, was highly problematic. So that's just an example, right? But folks have a hard time with saying that because David is, Jesus' descendant and, all this. So I think part of this is we need to be honest that messiness has always been present. And we need to stop cleaning up some of the messiness that we justified and go deep and talk about the real pain that's existed even in the text that we have. And so then we need to ask the question, is that God's best? So we can imagine that God intervened in these situations. That doesn't mean they constitute God's best. And because I think we've confused those two things, we now justify a lot of the things that happen. And does that make sense? So understanding what happened and understanding God's will and God's best are two different things. And I don't think we've distinguished between those two things, and I think that becomes an easy justification with, well, they went to war in the text. Yep, they did. Why did they go to war? And is that what God would have wanted them to do, or was that the result of the fact that there was a lot of messed up things, a lot of sin happening, right? So I think that's one of these big things. And for me, again, I find it more successful to ask people tough questions sometimes than to just tell them. Because if I just tell them,
It's like, oh, Mariama, she's such an activist. That's so nice.
and there are times when I feel like people think they're gonna get points for my activism. Like, I go to a church where the pastors are activists. Well, but what does that mean for you? Like, you don't accrue points for other people's action, right? And I get that we don't all have to play the same exact role, but like, I think some of it is pushing us on, there's some tough questions we need to answer for ourselves, and not even in a judgmental way. Like, I am very honest. There are things I believe to my core, and I'm still not getting them right. But at least I'm not trying to justify them. I try to move beyond a place where I'm trying to justify problematic things in my life, recognize they're problematic, sometimes even admit, I'm already working on 3 problematic things, so this will have to wait until next year or a couple of years after I get working on the, but I think holding, you know, so I do think on this issue, it's like we need to ask some tough questions. What would a Christian nation actually look like? Let's draw it out. Let's write it out. Let's imagine that. Now, after we've imagined that, let's score ourselves against that ideal. So I think some of it is like, people have gotten used to like saying specific things, just getting down with things. We haven't interrogated them. And so when you just push back with some other phraseology that they don't like, you don't get them to go there. And I think we have to ask some deep questions. Like, so we used to do a project when I was at Project Hip Hop where we'd give people a circle and we'd say, how would you spend the national budget based on how you believe the country should be? The chunk they would give to education was always way more than what's actually been given to education. They always imagined we were giving way more in foreign aid to other parts of the world than we were actually giving. So it wasn't, I didn't just give people like the facts. I started off from saying, imagine what you think it should be. Well, tell me what you think it is. And then when they had to look at what it should be versus what it is, that's where the deep reflection comes. Because if you give it to me what it is, then I start justifying why this, that, and the other. But when I have to look at the difference, those differences, I start asking myself some deep questions about why is it like that? And what should I be doing to go from where I believe we should be to where we actually are? And I think that dialogical approach is different than the sort of lecture style or sermon style. And you know, it's one of the things I'm sort of pushing in our own congregation. I know we have Sunday school, but then like not everybody comes to it. So one of the things I'm trying to do is push out what is possible even within a traditional sermon structure that requires people to do soul searching like in the moment. That gives people exercises that they could potentially do again somewhere else. Because I don't think, if I hold a workshop, I'm gonna get the same people that usually come. Although, actually post-Trump, lots of people who never used to come before are coming now, so if you're trying to push the envelope, now is the time to do it. But on the side note, usually when you invite people, you get the people that already care, and you don't get the people that are pushing themselves. So the question is, how do we even push our liturgy in ways that leads to self-reflection, that points the dissonance out there, and then invites people? Wouldn't it be awesome to be in a better place than we are right now? Don't we believe that the country needs a spiritual revival? What would it look like for us to be on fire and us to be an amazing relationship and people to walk in here and be like, whoa, there's something different going on here. Like reminding people that that is half, for many of us, it's why we come to church and then we just settle. It's why we come to study theology to figure out like, the meaning of life, and then we settle, right? So I think now is a moment to stop settling and to start pushing ourselves, and then also to reward people when they do push, because sometimes you'll fail, just to, you know, creativity also needs to fail you sometimes.
That was a fantastic talk, thank you very much. My question is regarding the conflation of religion and politics, and as I hear this advocacy for aligning oneself with compassionate politics, I fear that oftentimes that is perceived by those who would not otherwise agree with you as using compassion. so I'm curious how it is that, what your strategy is to decouple the real danger of aligning oneself with political platforms which justify themselves on the basis of compassion from your spiritual impulse to break down barriers and to inspire compassion beyond political division.
Yep. So a couple of things I would say to that. So first of all, I have found when you ask a lot of these questions, like for instance, what would a Christian nation look like, you're not gonna get as radically different answers from people who consider themselves conservatives than people who consider themselves liberal. When you start from the how it should be, you would be surprised how much alignment we have over, you know, the traditional platforms, et cetera, that people have. So I think that that's one of the things that's really important. The second thing is, I personally think, and this is, you know, I'll just be honest, I'm dubious of the state, period. The state has its certain kinds of things. It puts borders, and they decide who's in and who's out, and they have cutoff points about who gets it and who doesn't get it and all that stuff. And I get it. Like, I understand that. Our job is always to be pushing back on those things, like, to be asking tough questions. And so I am suspicious of being overly connected to the state, period. Because it has a role, right? I'm not saying abolish government and let's just figure out how to make it all work. I'm not, you know, foolish in that notion. But I do think there's a problem when we want to cozy up on any side. Because I think if you're not careful, you lose your ability to hold people accountable. And so I think a lot of our job is to say, this is what it should be. We recognize it will often fall far short. So I'm not saying, you know, we don't get that. But our job is still to stand for what should be, right? And so I see that as a role that's partially apart from the state, partially apart from government. I'm not saying, you know, I vote, I believe in all that. I choose the person who I think most aligns. But at the end of the day, for me, like, I don't pledge allegiance to anybody but Jesus, right? And that's very clear for me, right? Because people fail. I mean, I fail daily, right? And so I think the problem I have is with people investing. Like, I don't think we should give over to the state, which should only belong to God. But the state is a way of organizing our neighbors and how we live with our neighbors, and we do have a responsibility to care about that. So if we care about our neighbors, then we care about the laws and the rules and the structures that govern how we live together, but I don't think that those, our goal is to cozy up to those things. And so I think that's like this real tension, right? Because I do think, like even in my own community, there's some folks who are like, I'm just trying to get to heaven, right? And I'm like, so God gave you this 60 or whatever number of years that you get, 80, whatever, to just hold out? Like, I don't think that's aligned with what the scripture says, right? So I do think there's a tension there. But what I will say is I've had these powerful, I had a conversation with a guy who clearly voted for Trump. He didn't want to tell me that when the conversation happened. But it eventually became obvious. And we, you know, one of the things he said to me was, you know, more or less, he lives in a town, and I'm summarizing, lives in a town where for Thanksgiving and Christmas, all these people's kids are coming home, right? And the town swells, and then after the holidays, it goes back down, right? And the reason for it, he basically said, is that, like, once the plant closed down, nobody's kids could make a living in this town. So the people who did stay, people will come back to take care of parents or whatever, you end up just struggling. Right? So there's some people who have good jobs, there's a few people, but on the whole, the prosperity in that town is not what it was. And this man invested his life in this place with the assumption that his kids would come back, and his grandkids would live a few blocks over, and every once in a while he'd pick them up maybe 2 days a week and walk them to school. Like, all of these things are basic assumptions that you live your life out with, and that's just not true. And it's not just not true for him, it's not true for many people in his community. And what we know is, when you lose your children, when you lose, like, you know, and I'm not saying, I'm not trying to knock, everybody's gonna move a little bit, but the, like, you need, communities need to know that the next generation exists and that they're cultivating it. It's an important part of the human impulse. And so what he basically said is, Trump said he's gonna fix that, and that is why I voted for him. And I said to him, you know what? I live in a community too where not enough people have jobs. And so when you hear about a lot of the violence in the inner city, some of that's about our young people feeling like there is no other option for them. So the same thing that you're talking about is plaguing our communities in a slightly different way, but it's the same thing, right? This lack of opportunity, lack of this of sense that you can take care of yourself. I said, so what you're talking about, I want that too. He then said, I think the kind of leader that gets us there has got to love the people deeply, and I think we need some creative solutions that take us beyond where we are right now. And I said to him, I don't see that. In, you know, at that time he was still candidate, you know, or the president-elect Trump. And so we had a moment where I just realized what you want is not entirely different from what I want. Now, granted, there was a lot of, we didn't have a deep conversation about race, which we could have had, right? There's some other layers of conversation we could have had. But we did get down to the essence, which is that in some ways we want the same thing. And he chose a person he thought he could, that could deliver that. I will have questions about whether that person can deliver it. But what to me is more important than the candidates is, how do we open a real conversation in this country about the fact that people are hurting and that people don't even feel like they can be sure that their family can survive around them, right? That you bought a house and now your kids can't live in the same neighborhood because the prices are so high. These are the basic conversations that I think are driving us. We are just being, in my opinion, manipulated by two different parties who sell us answers, neither of which are the actual solutions to these problems. And so we need to talk about, we need to open a conversation about what the real solutions to some of these problems are, and I don't have those solutions. None of us by ourselves is gonna have them. And that is why I believe we need a radical move of the Holy Spirit, but also that we need to start talking to each other and asking deep questions, because the process of getting to those answers will be a combination of God speaking to us and us being willing to struggle and toil and get creative and think outside of the box to figure out how we get there. And I don't think, no political party is gonna deliver that to you. Beloved community is not built by candidates. It is not built by platforms or political parties. Those may be necessary things down the line, but it's built from a shared belief that we are in this together and a willingness not to throw anybody out, to keep finding and fighting for a solution that really, really holds each other as best we possibly can. So our job is to say, great, and it's still not good enough. We're gonna keep pushing. And if we're overly tied to any political party, in my opinion, or any institution that doesn't have that same drive, then we put ourselves at risk. And so again, not saying we shouldn't vote. I vote, I participate in elections, I support candidates, all of that. But that is not where the foundation of who I am as a member of the Jesus movement sits. It sits somewhere else, and I think we should, on all sides, make sure that we are planted in the solid ground and not on shifting sands. One more.
First off, just thank you for the interpretation of the story about Solomon. I've never heard that before, and it really speaks to anybody who's lost a kid. It's in, fits the definition of what I think of a decent theology program. My own social location is that I teach theology in public schools. Like, mm-hmm. I'm a full-time teacher. I've gone to divinity school twice. They didn't want to, and I work in the public schools, and when I gave them the form for this conference to take the day off, they were like, Trump, it's a very white district, very conservative. They're like, Trump and indecent in the same sentence? I don't think so. Mm-hmm. So they don't want to let me come, and I had to kind of justify and explain. And it can be really tough. And I really like what you said about believing that change is possible, because honestly, like, I will sit and I'll try to teach, you know, Huck Finn, these all-white classes, mm-hmm. and sometimes I worry that I'm just not getting through to them. Mm-hmm. So I guess my question is, what can I do when sometimes I don't even know if I believe that the change is possible? And I feel like I'm the only one trying to make that change in the situation where I'm at.
That's very real. I will just say, yesterday I was in a meeting where somebody was like, I'm going to pray for you. I was like, no, let's do it right now. So I just want to name that, like, if you really push up against this, you will have, you will meet dark nights of the soul, right? Like where people, where I believe that there is a good in each person. And I believe that deep down inside they want to manifest that. They don't live that out every day. I don't live that out every day, right? And so there are days where you run into a spate of people, whole communities, not living out of the best of who they are. And so I think a couple things. It's like, one, to recognize that a piece of that is just normal, like a piece of it is par for the course. Because once I recognize that like every day people will not be their highest selves, then I don't get totally discouraged or disappointed when they aren't being their highest selves. And I recognize, I remind myself how often I am not my highest self, how I'm still working on issues that I've known about for 10 friggin' years that I'm teaching other people about and still not quite getting right myself, right? So I just like try to hold that because I think it's like I've noticed this after the election, the people who are having the hardest time bouncing back from like depression are the most privileged people, mm-hmm. right? And that's because I think if you have already been in a place of like oppression, you've had to bounce back a few times, so you're like, okay, like I gotta bounce back now, right? So a couple things. So I would just say, and again, I totally love this conference, totally get it. I am not going to give Donald Trump this much attention. I just on the point that if a person is a narcissist, the worst thing that you can do is allow them to, like, you're not helping them if you allow them to, like, do. I don't know how any of you all work with young people who, like, will try to shock value you, right? You've got to stop responding. Like, it doesn't mean that you don't hold them accountable, but, like, you cannot be like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you did that! Because, like, that is exactly, like, it feeds the situation, right? So, I try not to. Like, even this morning, I was like, I don't do news before a certain hour. Because I know what's going to be at the top of it, and, like, I need at least for the first hour of my day to be shaped from the idea that I come from a tradition of thousands of years of us trying to get it right and that God can intervene in it. And, like, if I get CNN, like, before 8 a.m., right, like, it's not a good thing. So I want to say, you know, to be careful about, like, I'm okay with it, like, I'm all good with indecency, and it's a trigger word for some people, so I can do the same exact thing without just using that word. Mm-hmm. And they're like, yeah, this is so powerful. Like, I've done, like, literally just changed the name of the workshop for a different group. Same exact concept. Content. Because trigger words are just like, they start people from a place of skepticism, and then you're trying to get them to, like, overcome the skepticism. So, like, for instance, like, I've gotten to places where I'm like, let's dig into the word. Like, and I know I'm gonna like propose things that people like would label postmodern and all sorts of other things that they like would not be down with. But it's like, let's stop with the labels and let's just like go there, right? And that's what I'm saying is like, you would be surprised how often when you let people start from just like the basic place, they come, like I truly believe there is something within us that knows often what decency really is. Like, we want to be motivated by love. We don't really want to be afraid of each other. Now, often we've gotten used to being in those places, so there's a safety there, but it's not actually like where we want to be. So I think both you need to recognize that like people we all operate from our safe space, and unfortunately, because of the way like our politics are, the way our families are, there's a whole bunch of dynamics that create what safe space is for us in often very safe ways of being that I should say comfortable. This is what I'm comfortable doing. This is what I've been comfortable being. These are the things I'm comfortable talking about. These are the words I'm comfortable hearing, right? And if you challenge those outright, sometimes it's not helpful, right? Like if you want people to go deep, challenge them at the deep place, not at the starting place, right? Because then they won't come with you into the journey. And that's the other thing I would say is, you've got to recognize this. Sorry. This is a journey. You don't walk into a congregation that's never done any activism and be like, let's go get state house. Like, that is like terrible idea. You probably set that congregation back like 10 years from ever even thinking about civil disobedience as a possibility. So yes, was Jesus doing tons of civil disobedience? All the time. But if your congregation ain't there, if your people aren't there, don't start with that, right? Start with like, let's have a conversation about what it means to live our lives like based on our values. Let's write out our values. Let's write out what the actions that we be connected with our values are. And then let's ask, how many times did we do those things? Or let's take out our checkbook. Let's look at the last 10 checks. Did they align with how you think God would want us to use our resources? What would we need to do to make that happen more? Are there things we're spending on that maybe don't align? Things that we could, like, so I just think starting people from where they are and asking, because people who, if you can help your people to live a self-reflective life, they will do the work themselves. And so I think that if you just get them used to pushing themselves to a place of questions and let the young people ask crazy, like they will go, I've never had young people have trouble pushing on intense questions. Shock value does sometimes work for the teen set, like not great necessarily for older folks because they shut off, but for the teen group, I walk in and be like, oh, Jesus doesn't want you to go to college. What do you think? Like, you know, I don't actually even believe that, but like, you know, and getting them to argue why that might be true and why that, we had a big debate on should Christians celebrate Christmas? Like, nobody even asked that question. And so then we started asking, like, what would it mean? How are we celebrating Jesus' birthday? Does that seem in alignment? What should our biggest holiday actually be? And this year, though, we should celebrate one, but 2 years ago, though, we shouldn't celebrate. But it made our young people ask tough questions about this quasi-religious, sort of religious, but really very secular holiday that we have, and like, should we even be down with it? Does it eat, like, is it so far gone that we should just let it go? So I just think that like, yes, people will act a mess, but then you'll be a mess too. And then sometimes, unfortunately, those two things happen on the same day, and that's why you just ask for the Spirit. Like, Spirit, I need a reset. Tell me how to get to that reset. Tell me how to, you know. So, anyway, and she does come through. Like, I have found, there have been times where I've been like, Spirit, I think I just totally offended that person. Could you just help me figure out how we get from this moment to the moment where 2 years from now I say this was a transformative thing that happened? I just need it to be a transformative thing that happened, and I don't know how to. And I know I sound like I'm testifying. It is a part of my tradition. I can't tell you how many times she comes through. Like I prayed all in Germany. We were voting on whether or not our church is going to become a level one or level two sanctuary church. I decided I'm going to pray for every steward. I'm going to pray for them, not because I want them to do what I want them to do. I said, God, you know, I have a desired outcome. But I'm actually hoping that your will is done. And I want you to actually prepare me if your will is not for us to be a level one sanctuary, because I'll be very disappointed. And I said, I talk very honestly with God. Like, I will be angry. I will need some days to get over it. But I'm saying this because I know I should be desiring your will and not my own. What does that mean? It means when I go to the steward board, I actually have prepared myself to hope that God's will be done and not my will, and that I'm not trying to strong arm people into doing what I think they should be doing. I'm laying out what is possible. And they all voted. And we still have a lot of work to do, and the lawyer, there's other work to do. But they all went with all the trustees, the church, people are getting excited. We were not in this place a month and a half ago. It's not me. I know that the Spirit moved. The pastor, the day before, had a meeting with another Latino pastor who was talking about the challenges in his church. I couldn't have set that up. So I do think, again, I know I'm like being a little preachy on the Holy Spirit side, and we're at a theology school, but just want to say, the Holy Spirit comes through. Just ask for what you need. So with that, I know we are at lunch, and I don't want to stand between everyone and food, but I want to thank you for your engagement. Most of you know how to reach me. I'm not here very much anymore because I'm kind of working full time, but I do still have an email, mariama@bu.edu. So thank you so much.